Hello, Gramzy here from Metalcat, and today we are talking about an upcoming VR game we're working on called Grimlord. We're really excited to show everyone the progress we've made so far and show you exactly what you need to know to get started. So, here we go. The Grimlord demo will be coming to Steam VR first, and followed sequentially by demos for the Quest 2, and eventually, PSVR 2. Currently, MetaQuest and Rift S are the two platforms with the best optimization, but we're always continuously updating the game on other platforms, like HTC devices, and including the adaptation of the Valve Index. For now, we don't have full finger tracking implemented yet, but we're working on it. It's not recommended to play Grimlord on virtual desktop, as compatibility is unstable on the game's current version. Grimlord makes use of a full body IK system, meaning your body has presence and space in the virtual world. Your body moves with you, your legs run when you run, and your arms have presence when you swing your weapon. This also allows you to grab and assign your equipment to various slots on your in-game body. When your hands are hovering above equipment, you can see additional information pop up in a window, giving you a look at its stats. There are visual cues for which weapon holster you can put your weapon on, as well as audio cues to confirm that your weapon or item has been slotted correctly. There are two heavy weapon slots on your back, which are dedicated to larger weapons and shields. A UI prompt will come up when you successfully place a weapon in the slot. You have two lighter weapon slots on each side of your waist, dedicated for medium and small size weapons, such as scimitars, daggers, or short swords. There are two slots in the middle of the waist, specifically for potions. Item slots are not interchangeable. Each slot serves its own purpose. Heavy weapons go on your back, light and medium weapons go on your waist, and potions sit in the middle of your belt. The potion system in Grimlord is pretty straightforward and operates fairly intuitively to anyone who has played any kind of RPG game before. As expected, red potions heal you and restore your life, and blue potions restore your mana. While you're in town, you can assign up to two potions of either kind at a time to your belt. Potions are replenished automatically if you die, rest, or teleport anywhere. While you're fighting for your life inside Grimlord, sometimes monsters will drop random small health potions as loot that you can either consume immediately or store on your belt for later if you have a slot available. Each weapon has its own unique weight and its own center of gravity. Lightweight weapons are much more stable to swing, generally faster, and are primarily suitable for single-handed use. Heavy weapons will be more stable when held with both hands, but they require better coordination between both of your arms. Because every single weapon has its own unique properties, weight, and physics, it's likely that most weapons will take some time to master, and that no two weapons will act exactly the same in a fight. During battle, there are a number of attacks you can levy against your enemies, ranging a variety of damage types. The primary damage types are slashing, stabbing, and bludgeoning, and operate just as one might guess. For the most part, every single weapon in the game is capable of these damage types. However, since some are designed to deliver a specific type of damage more effectively, you may find them more useful with certain attacks. There are also elemental damage types from the frost, fire, and lightning staves in the game, as well as bows, which also do stabbing or piercing damage. While bows and sorcery staves are extremely powerful compared to melee weapons, they offer little in the way of protection and are generally much more difficult to use. We'll go a little bit more in depth on these weapons later. Of course, we want our players to be able to play exactly the way that they want to, and to be able to enjoy the combat in as many ways as possible, which is why we've implemented an extremely robust smithing and crafting system. There's a wide array of weapons to choose from and create, and within each one, you can customize them even further, swapping out blade styles, hilts, or handles to create your perfect or ideal weapon. Be careful, however. Every part on the weapon changes its physics, weight, and stats, so know that it will take some time to master your newly crafted weapons. While looking inside the smithy to craft new weapons, you can see how each part of the weapon changes its individual stats. Chop is the damage done to enemies that slashing attacks would create and will only apply to blade edges like those on swords, axes, or the edge of a halberd. Blunt is the bludgeoning damage done to enemies from non-sharpened parts of the weapon. Handles, hilts, and punching all fall under this category. Destabilize indicates how powerful or just how much momentum can be generated with a particular weapon, which can increase chances to temporarily incapacitate, stun, or disarm your opponents. Pricking or piercing damage is done to enemies from sharp stabbing attacks, such as those from the point of a sword or a spear. The little bar next to pricking damage indicates the level of armor sunder effect or how much armor the weapon ignores when performing a piercing attack. For example, the boss's armor has an extremely high level of protection, which may require a legendary weapon to sunder the armor in order to do damage more effectively. When you hover over a weapon, also consider the cost, the weight, single-handed versus double-handedness, and any accessory elements it may have. Just like in real life, if you anticipate your opponents accurately and time your reactions appropriately, you can parry your enemy's attacks, which are indicated by a distinct audio-visual cue. Additionally, you have a parry bar at the bottom of your screen, just above your health and mana bars. Every time you successfully parry an enemy's attack, this bar will fill. Be careful, however. If you successfully parry enough enemy attacks to fill the bar completely, it will deplete and cause you to drop your weapon, opening you up to attacks from enemies. So be sure to pay attention to this bar during combat. Use your non-dominant hand to hold a bow, and use your dominant hand to reach for your waist where your quiver is located. Press the trigger button to remove arrows from your quiver, and press trigger button again to draw the bow and shoot. The position of the quiver actually changes based on which hand is holding the bow, so if you enjoy switching dominant hands frequently or are ambidextrous, it will be very easy for you to do so. We are planning on expanding on this a bit further in the future so as to add a bit more customizability to this feature as well. The mechanics of holding two-handed weapons are very different from other VR fighting games like Blade and Sorcery, and much more accurately simulates the realistic power and weight behind these weapons of war. Whichever hand is closest to the weapon's center of gravity will be identified by the game as your dominant hand, meaning your dominant hand can be adjusted or switched quickly and frequently at any contact point on the weapon. In Grimlord, every single part of your weapon can be touched, gripped, and interacted with meaningfully, giving players new and ever-increasingly creative ways to slay their enemies. Staves make up for what they lack in brute strength and melee prowess with strong and powerful ranged magical attacks. To harness your staff's power, you first need to activate its magical rune symbols. For fire, draw a circle. For frost, draw a triangle. And for lightning, draw a lightning bolt. These will activate your staff, which you can then use to either hit the trigger while hitting the ground, to activate a powerful ranged AoE or area of effect attack. You can also expend the staves rune with the trigger to blast your enemies with a powerful single target ranged spell attack. Performing these actions, however, will consume your mana and require you to reactivate the rune symbol for your staff. Weapon storage and weapon recovery in Grimlord is pretty straightforward. If there is a weapon you don't need or just don't want, drop it in the barrel next to your storage chest to get some gold for your efforts. You can now use this gold to craft other new and powerful items at the smith. If you walk over to your storage chest, you can simply drop weapons you are no longer using into it to store it safely until you decide to use it again. To do so, simply click on spawn and the weapon will appear in front of you. Don't worry, if you dropped one of your weapons in a dungeon or missed any weapons that dropped off of an enemy, they'll show up automatically in your chest when you return to town. Legends say there's a mysterious loot goblin responsible for these weird happenings. In town, you can teleport to any save point you've previously acquired using the Sapphire Pedestal. During your adventures, you will see Sapphire Pedestals throughout Grimlord that will all look very similar to one another. You can use these to rest, thereby healing you, restoring your equipment, and saving your game. You can also use these to travel back to town or teleport to any other previous save points you've acquired in-game. And finally, there's a lot of mysteries in Grimlord, and a lot of things for the players players to discover. Make sure you check every door, grab every handle and switch, or maybe look for things that appear out of place. Who knows? Maybe you'll find a hidden passage or a secret room. Keep your eyes open, keep your wits about you, and good luck.